And so, without further ado, let us put our hands together to welcome Professor Brian Arthur.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you very much indeed, Jonathan. Well, I'm delighted to be here. I flew in last night from London, and I only just got here, and I'm thrilled to see so many people I know in the audience, including many people I've known for a long, long time. What I want to talk about is, it's a daring title, that there is a shift in Western thought or Western scientific thought, and that it has something to do with complexity. Trying to zero something out. Good. The usual idea that we have in complexity, it's a bit self-aggrandizing, is that around about the early 1980s, we all got desktop workstations, so we all could investigate experimentally on our computers in the early 80s what happened when different systems unfolded or evolved in front of our eyes. This gave a bottom-up version of science rather than a top-down reductionist one. And as a result of that, science has had a different view ever since. So we've gone from reductionism to thinking in terms of how systems construct themselves and patterns emerge. Therefore, science is different. I thought about that quite recently, at least in the last 2 years, and I've decided, in fact, this is the story I used to tell people, I've decided there's much more going on than that. The true story, I think, is a great deal deeper than that, and complexity, as a result, is a bit less important than those of us that have been concerned with complexity would like to think. So I want to give you a different story this morning, and I want to go back. We may as well start from quite far back. Where I've decided to start is in fairly arbitrarily the year 1686. In that year, Newton was finishing up his Principia Mathematica. And I've chosen this year because I think it's pivotal. Newton was writing the Principia in 1685 and 1686. He published it in June 1687. So those were the years when he was thinking and revising. What's quite remarkable, the Principia, by the way, if you don't know, is where Newton sets out his universal law of gravitation, and where he figures out an incredibly simple mathematical system for the orbits of planets, reduced to just a few equations. It was staggering, it was elegant, it was completely dazzling. Let's see if I can get something to happen here. Can't. Perhaps someone could help me. Oh, I've got the wrong flipper. Thank you. So Newton's working in this 1686. My guess is he thought a lot of the thing through in English. That's just a guess, he was English, but the book or the three volumes are written in Latin. He also, and this is significant, thought most of it through in what we would call algebraic equations with the help of something he had invented, the theory of intesimals, what has come to be called the modern calculus, which he invented along with Leibniz. Newton figured out the entire theory in algebraic equations and with the help of the calculus. And then he went back and rewrote the entire thing, all the mathematics in terms of geometry. And I find that was quite remarkable. So what I want to point out is that in 1686 or thereabouts, there is a shift from science being expressed in geometry, the first time science being expressed fully in terms of equations. That's not quite true. It was really after Newton that this became possible and fashionable. Newton went the other direction, thought in terms of equations, but being trying to conform to the day expresses everything in geometry. In fact, before him, Johannes Kepler had insisted that mathematics has nothing to do with algebra. Mathematics is basically geometry. Galileo thought the same. All the major mathematicians and scientists of the 1600s think in terms of geometry, although some of them, like Newton, are starting to use equations. The point I want to make is this is the moment in which science pivots from expressing itself in geometry to expressing itself in terms of equations. I want to take about 50 years later, we're now in 1733. What Newton has produced has been dazzling. He's had predecessors, Galileo, before that Descartes, and many others. But what Newton produced, the simplicity, the elegance, was absolutely staggering and dazzling. And that gave rise, in no small part, to the Enlightenment, the Western Enlightenment, with a lot of ideas that nature was knowable, that behind all the chaos of nature were simple laws, and that everything was basically ordered. The high expression of this came around 1733. I've chosen this more or less at random. This is Alexander Pope, great English poet and thinker. He was in a small group that included Jonathan Swift and others. But now we have the High Enlightenment, which is basically a massive intoxication brought on by Newton's thinking and the thinking of other scientists of the 1600s. So Pope sums it all up. Here's one stanza of his poem, An Essay on Man, 1733. Think of this as a reaction to what Newton and others had accomplished. All nature is but art unknown to thee, all chance direction which thou canst not see. So the idea of all nature is art, not art as we think of it, but artifice. So all nature unknown to us is basically mechanism. All nature has simple mechanical laws behind it, or knowable laws behind it. What we think of as chaos or chance has simplicity or direction behind it, if only we could see that simplicity and direction. All that we think of as an unholy mess really has harmonic laws behind it. So there are principles behind everything. It's knowable if only we are smart enough to know it, and it's basically simple and expressible. And if we take all the various pieces working together, partially, they may appear to be just proceeding in their own selfish interests, but what they produce together has some perfection to it, some harmony, some universal good. And one truth is clear, whatever is right. That last quote, by the way, is from Socrates. Whatever is right. So all of this marvelous planetary system, what we have in the universe, is knowable, it's amazing, it's expressible, it's got simplicity and mechanism behind it, and there's some degree of perfection or some high perfection behind it. Whatever is right. Notice the word reason. In that century, reason was regarded as feminine and usually capitalized. So this is an ode to rationality. All that we know out there is rational, well-ordered, well-expressed, if only we had the equations. And that, in turn, has given rise, and pardon me if I'm simplifying a bit because I could say there's 25 buts and exceptions to all of this. That's given rise, by and large, to an idea of Western science that there are four major things something has to have, some system if we're to regard it as science, that the world, at least the part of the world in question that we're looking at, say the astronomical system, is orderly, it's well ordered. There is artifice or mechanism behind it, that if this is truly science, just as we think of Newton, we should be able to express all that in terms of equations, that it's predictable. Very often people say to me, well, can you use that system to predict? Because if it's not predictable, it's not science. And things are either in some form of stasis or cycles or equilibrium, but there's something ordered or not so much static, but something that's rather eternal behind all of this and in some way in harmony. By the way, a lot of this thinking that I was doing came up because I had written a book that Jonathan mentioned. It's called The Nature of Technology. And at the center of the evolution of technology, I'd figured there was an algorithm or a series of steps. And I thought this was a great breakthrough. I'd spent 12 years trying to figure out how technology evolved. I wrote it down in a book. And one of my friends who teaches at Oxford, and a very smart guy indeed, I won't give his name, but he said, you know, that's all very fine, Brian. I like your book. But it's not scientific. I said, what do you mean it's not scientific? You know, he says, well, what's missing are the equations. I said, equations? You know, it's like telling a cordon bleu cook, you know, you have a recipe, that's an algorithm. That's not really scientific. Just give me the equations. So I was horrified, and I began to wonder, does science have to be equation-based at all? A lot of other people have thought of this too. So if things are orderly, predictable, equation-based, and generally in harmony or stasis, there's an embarrassing fact here. Biology is challenging the four pillars. You could take evolution, which Darwin, or you can take cellular action, cells signaling to each other and doing things together, or indeed cells evolving. Or you could take embryology, the evolution or development of individual organisms, or the way proteins are expressed, or genetic regulatory networks, how genes switch other genes on and switch genes off, which is a huge logical, almost like a digital network of logic going on. None of these are particularly, well, they're sort of ordered, but they're very open systems. They're certainly not predictable. At least much of this isn't predictable. If I said, tell me where such and such a genetic regulatory network is going to go next, most biologists would say, I mean over the next 500,000 years, most biologists will say, we don't quite know. We can't predict that. When are the next dinosaurs going to arrive? How will things speciate? How will protein expression work its way out? None of this is particularly predictable. It's not easily expressed by equations. One of the curious things is that 150 or more years after Darwin's Origin of Species was published, we still don't have the equations. People will point out, well, there are, you know, the Hardy-Wright equations for one allele changing, but these are rather trivial parts of the system. Nearly all of biology is not expressed in equations, yet, and this is the embarrassing fact, we would claim this is still science. Biology is, if anything, the science of the moment, but it doesn't conform to the four pillars. So this is an embarrassment. And computation itself is a bit of an embarrassment. It's a lot younger than biology. We've really only had computation for the last 80 years or so, or a theory of computation. But it doesn't really conform either, and this is really what I want to talk about. So I'm going to claim that science is undergoing a shift from being expressed in equation form to being algorithmically expressed, or expressed in terms of mathematical algorithms or a series of instructions. That's what I want to argue, and I think there's an awful lot that is changing as we change from just having things equation-based to thinking in terms of algorithms. So that's what I want to look at in detail. Let me talk a little bit about the equation-based setup. If you're trained mathematically, most of us are here, at least I was, you're trained to think in terms of equations, you know, dx d tau, or how x is changing over time t is minus sigma times x plus sigma times y, and so on. These are rather famous equations. They're equations out of meteorology. They're the equations that Ed Lorenz worked with in the 1960s. Lorenz is the guy, if you remember, that invented the butterfly effect, or at least thought that up. And he was one of the first people to discover and talk about what came to be known as chaos theory. So these equations look very simple. Notice they're not linear. But they're telling us how this system changes over time. And the right side of these equations is basically saying if you filled in values for x and y and z, you would know where the system is, and you could plug these in, and it would tell you where each of these variables was going next. So basically, this is an updating system. It's a dynamic system. And for a lot of the argument I'm giving here, I will talk in terms of time or dynamics. But there's a much wider argument to be given beyond that. I just want to keep things relatively simple here. Basically, if you know where you are in the system, if you know values for x, y, and z, you would know where the system is going. So in cases like this, we have an updating rule. That's the dx dt, where x is going over time. It depends on where the system currently is. So you can think of the current system position as being like a ball on a smooth surface. I prefer to think of it as a toboggan or a luge moving along a well-defined path down a hill. These Lorentz equations, or any equation that's smooth tends to give you a surface. This happens to be a rather complicated surface. I won't go through this in much detail. I'm just merely pointing out that equation-based systems we generally take as being smooth or fairly smooth. They may have a lot of complication to them, but what they have in common is great elegance and beauty. And I'm not against this. I've spent just about all my career on systems like this, usually probabilistic versions. So I am very much an admirer of the sort of beauty you see here. But what I want to point out is if you're here in this system, it tells you where you're going next. As I said, this happens to be a rather complicated version that you can't predict too far. I want to move forward to a year now, 1936, that I think is pivotal. Just as 1686 was pivotal, 1936 was a special year. I've chosen it a bit arbitrarily, but I think it's well chosen. So this is exactly 250 years after Newton, the shift from geometry to equations. And it's roughly 200 years after Alexander Pope gives his ode to rationality and rational science. That's the year Alan Turing published his famous paper on computable numbers with an application to the Entscheidungsproblem. He says here, if you're trying to make this out, with a few corrections to misprints, etc. So Turing is still fairly young. He's a student at Cambridge still. He hasn't yet gone to America. I may be wrong in that by a year or so, but I think that this is roughly when the paper comes out. This paper, I think, is very beautiful indeed. And I would make an argument, or there is an argument to be made, that this is the most influential paper in mathematics of the last couple of hundred years. We could argue this till the cows come home, but this paper is spectacular. It's beautiful. It's essentially the thinking that invented the computer, which didn't exist at the time. But this paper is deep and very, very beautiful. What interested Turing was, in fact, what was in the air in 1936 and before that, was an idea that had been mooted around by David Hilbert and others, great mathematicians, that maybe mathematics could be mechanized. Maybe there's out there some marvelous machine, at least in our minds, where if we could feed in something to this marvelous machine, doesn't exist in reality, but conceptually it could exist, that machine, say, could tell us whether a mathematical statement we feed in is true or false, whether we have a theorem or not. And so all of these ideas were in the air in the 1920s and 1930s. And Turing, who's notoriously literal-minded, was interested in whether there could be a machine to carry out certain tasks in mathematics. At that time, there were computers. They're sitting down at desks here, or at least some of them have calculators. But a computer, generally speaking, was a man or a woman. This is the computing division. This happens to actually be the computing division of the Veterans Affairs Department just after World War I. And these people are figuring out bonuses for the veterans of the First World War. They probably have some adding machines. You can see a few keys or some rather simple equipment with a little bit of tape here. But don't kid yourself. These are not digital computers or anything like them. This is a computer here, a calculator, and this man and that person as well, and the supervisors. What Turing was interested in, he went to talk to such people. He was interested in things like knitting machines. He was interested in clockwork. He was interested in how things worked. So he decided he would talk to these people and look into exactly what it meant to do a calculation. Now, it might be a calculation of trigonometry tables or logarithmic tables, or it might be a fancy calculation to do with Bessel functions, or it might be a simple calculation such as adding numbers. But Turing was interested in how human beings, how computers did this, and whether that could be mechanized. So he talked to people like this, and he came to what I think is a rather interesting conclusion. The standard setup, remember, we were just looking at equations, is that there's an updating rule. If you know where you are in Lorentz's system, if you know exactly where the values are, if you know where your toboggan is on the slope, you can say exactly where it's going to go next. Turing figured out that was true of calculation. If you have two numbers and you're trying to add them, you know what the two numbers are, so you can have a lookup table and figure out where you're going to go next. But, and this is the genius, he noticed there was a subtlety. Here's a subtlety. The standard setup, that's in equations, there's an updating rule, depending on exactly where you are. Turing says, yes, there's an updating rule if you have two numbers, but he allowed that the updating rule could shift depending on the inner state of the system. He noticed people, and he looked in great detail at how humans do this, and he noticed that they kept track of where they are in the calculation. Sometimes they had a little notebook or a piece of paper, and they would jot down simple things. So the inner state or what he called the state of mind of the calculation also mattered. So here's a trivial example. Suppose you're adding some number that ends in 17 and another number that ends in 19 or 29 or something. These are long numbers, and you're adding those two numbers. The 7 and 9 will give you 16. So you can look up that and write down a 6. But then you have to carry 1. So in the next part of the calculation for the tens, you have to remember the system has changed. We need to add a 1 to it. Totally trivial. But I maintain that this triviality here has changed science. The carry 1 or not carry 1, the state flips. Am I carrying 1 next time, or am I not carrying 1? The inner state of the system can flip. There are many other ways it can flip, but carry 1 is pretty trivial. So what Turing was really saying is that it's not just where you are that counts. The inner state of the system, whether I need to carry 1 or not, or whether I need to do some other operation or not, also counts when humans are making a calculation, or for that matter, if you want to design a machine to make a calculation. You have to allow that the state of the mind of the person calculating alters the next step, or may alter it. And I want to point out that this state of mind, Turing had some fairly simple things in mind, the way humans do calculations, but this state of mind is absolutely crucial. Because if you think, I might be deciding I'm going to have dinner tonight or maybe not have dinner tonight, but my state of mind is probably relatively complicated. In fact, that's what human beings are all about. You can't predict exactly what we're going to do. Our states of mind, in fact, we call that mind itself, can be arbitrarily complicated. Say with someone like Doug Carmichael, who's a friend of mine, it can be enormously complicated. So what Turing had allowed was that the calculation or the next step could be affected by something, not just a lookup table, but where the system itself was. That inner state can easily express conditions. If such and such is happening, then the inner state's going to change, then you do something different. So this has led, immediately you can do something that I would call conditional logic. If I'm making some calculation, and if the sum of something is less than that, and if the integral of something else is greater than something else, and if this condition is false, then if all that happens, then execute R and S and T, otherwise do something else. What Turing had introduced in calculation was allowing that the logic of the situation could be considered along with the calculation itself. And this is crucial. Turing is in a world that we call algorithms. But these algorithms were not just blindly updating depending on where you are. The algorithms were taking into account the context of where the situation is and how that context was changing over time, and that affects the further calculation. So we're now in an algorithmic world. So just to sum up to here, we have an equation-based setup. I'll call that the Newtonian setup. So where you go next is totally dependent on where you are. Or an Alan Turing algorithmic setup that is also position dependent. It's where you go next depends on where you are. But it also depends on the context. And that context may keep changing, might even change probabilistically. Notice that this algorithmic or Turing setup is a generalization of this one. So the algorithmic setup is very much an equation-based setup or very similar, but context for the first time becomes important. I want to add some caveats at this stage because this is to shorten the Q&A part of it. People say, well, there's an exception to the third or the 13th slide you gave. So I want to point out some things. And this is the small print, so I've written it in small print. An algorithmic system, so if you have an algorithm, in principle, it can be expressed mathematically. Basically, all algorithms can be reduced to equations. You'd have an awful lot of ones and zeros. And it would normally be incredibly cumbersome to write all of this out. But it's still true that we don't necessarily do that because what we have is the state of the system is being tracked as that changes. And equations can pick up some context too. So I'm not saying that equations are devoid of all of this. Alan Turing wasn't the first to think of algorithms. I think somebody called Mr. Algorithm, Arab. His first name wasn't Al, but he was the Gorithm person, must have cooked up algorithms, but they go way back to the time of the Greeks and earlier. And the standard equation setup is a special case of the algorithmic one. The algorithmic one is generalizing the Newtonian system by allowing for context dependence. What I want to ask is this trivial, almost trivial difference that Turing put his finger on, that the context of the situation affects what happens next. What are the consequences of that? I think the consequences are actually quite profound. This is what I want to look at now. Notice, first of all, that Turing's world is by and large a process world. Because we can say, if this condition is true, that's part of the context, then do such and such. If you do such and such and that alters the situation and context, then do such and such. So we can model processes using algorithms. Equation-based systems, you're modeling the amount of something or the position of something. You're dealing with nouns. For the first time with Turing's system, we can deal with verbs. We can deal with processes. So we can deal with things triggering things. In fact, if you want to push this, and this is where computation takes us, we are in a world of possibly parallel processes, highly context dependent, and they could be enormously complicated, and that's what we call computation. They can also be probabilistic, and these are the sort of systems that I and many of you in the room have been working with. They can be agent-based, as Robert Mark showed us in 1986, very early on. But what I want to point out is this is the way life works. Everything biological is basically driven by process, events triggering events, combinations of events inhibiting events, other combinations triggering yet other, and all of this highly context dependent. How does complexity fit into this? And there's a question for Jan. we're talking about emergent patterns in this. How does complexity fit together with this point of view of Turing's? I am attempting an answer here. You may not agree, but here's my answer. Complexity, as I see it, studies systems whose elements react to the pattern they create. So if the elements are cars on a road, and the pattern is what you'd call local traffic. If there's a traffic jam, the cars all slow down and react to the pattern that those cars have together created. So the cars are creating traffic patterns, and the traffic patterns they are reacting to. That's a complex system. That's basically at the back of all we do. So the elements are reacting to the context they've together created. The algorithmic updating system depends on the inner state of the system as well as on where you are, so it depends on the context. This allows the system to react to the context it creates. Notice much the same. And that allows me to say, complexity is the natural study of systems that react to their inner context. Basically, a complex system is one whose elements are reacting to the emergent pattern, name of the conference, or the context that they've together created. And that in turn would mean, I haven't written this down here, complexity is the natural study of how algorithmic systems, which react to the context they create, evolve. So complexity is the natural study of how step-by-step or algorithmic systems evolve. That means that complexity isn't driving algorithms. The advent of algorithms has given rise to complexity studies. And again, in the fine print, I want to say, if you're studying algorithms, which I've done an awful lot in my life and many other people have here, you might be studying rates of convergence or what's called the degree of complication or complexity. Is it NP complete? All these sorts of algorithms. There's much more to be said about algorithms than complexity comprises. But basically, complexity is the natural study of algorithmic systems. What does all this do to the four pillars of science? So if you shift from equation-based Newtonian systems to Turing-based algorithmic system, how does that work out? Well, this is how does orderedness work out? Algorithmic expression captures systems that are interrelated, parallel, highly context-dependent, and very often probabilistic too. Does that still give you an ordered system? I would say yes. This is actually a photograph. Doesn't look like it, but it is a photograph of the Cooper River. That's in South Carolina in the US. It's probably taken from a plane. You notice the water is actually glinting here, probably reflecting the sun. And you get little thingies here. I don't know what those are. They could be houses or cars. But that's, believe it or not, is a photograph of a river basin. It's easy algorithmically, given a topography, to start such a system off and allow it to develop algorithmically until you have such an outcome, highly patterned, maybe a little bit dependent on initial probabilistic events, but nevertheless quite highly ordered, but complicated, and maybe open, maybe changing over time, maybe not keeping the same exact pattern over time. So yeah, by and large, you still get order, meaning that there is something reasonable or rational behind it all. But notice now it can be quite complicated, and it could be changing over time. Is it predictable? Are algorithmic systems in general predictable? This is a bit of a deeper question. I like the Greg Chaitin, who we were hoping we would have here this morning. Great, great mathematician, has worked on this. I very much recommend and like Chaitin's work. By the way, I was at a conference in northern Sweden one time with Chaitin and others. John Maynard Smith was there. And it was in May. We were way above the Arctic Circle in a little town called Abisko for this conference. And the sun didn't set. This was midday sun. So I turned to Greg Chaitin and I said, Greg, if the sun doesn't set up here, what does it do? And Chaitin says, I don't know. He said, it's a long time since I studied projective geometry. So I'm an engineer. What I did was I got up every 2 hours and looked at what the sun was doing. It was just going round and round the heavens, peeping a little bit above the mountains at every moment. Anyway, Turing's version of prediction and Greg Chaitin's idea is that predictions are basically theories of what's going to happen at some future time, obviously, and the theories ought to be shorter than just working the whole thing out and waiting and seeing what you get. In other words, when Edmund Halley in the early 1700s started to make predictions about a certain comet, there were two or three comets that had appeared with some regularity. Halley figured they may be the same comet reappearing around the 1740s or 1730s when he was figuring this out, used Newton's system, a simple theory, and predicted when it would reappear. He was correct within about a year. The refinements, he didn't live to see it appearing. This was in the 1760s. Halley had already died, but this was Halley's comet. Point is that you get prediction when there's a theory that's shorter than working the whole thing out. Halley could have waited to see did the comet appear, but that wouldn't have been much of a prediction. The basic way to think of prediction, or the cleanest and nicest way, is the theory of cellular automata. And I want to mention Stephen Wolfram here. I won't say that Wolfram is the greatest scientist of the 20th or 21st century. I will leave that to him. But Wolfram came up, oh God, they're recording this. I'll say nothing more. Wolfram is someone I greatly admire. And what Wolfram has done in the last 20 years is use a particular type of algorithm, it's called a cellular automaton, to look into questions of prediction and how algorithms behave. Cellular automata were cooked up by Stanislaw Ulam in Los Alamos, New Mexico, and von Neumann in the mid-1940s. And you don't need to understand cellular automata for what I'm going to show you next or what Wolfram is showing us. But basically think of cellular automata as a band of little pixels or squares that could be black or white or one or zero. And the band reproduces itself down below the next time. But each pixel turns to be black or white depending on some rule having to do with its neighbors previously. So if you have pixel number 17, it's looking to what pixel 15, 16, 17, 18, and 19 were doing the previous time. There are many, many such rules. So just think of cellular automata as being very visual, very simple algorithms or computer programs. Wolfram, who I'm a great admirer of, to be serious, has looked at these and used them as a kind of experimental lab for thinking about algorithms. So here's one version of this algorithm. All the top here looks blank, but these are all white cells. One little black cell. And then according to one particular rule that he's picked out, this system evolves like this. So this black cell stays black next time and so on, but then you get it turning white. This white cell is gradually turning black, and you get this sort of an emergent pattern. If you had this sort of system, you could predict. If I asked you what's going to happen in the 1,101,000th time this whole thing is evolving, evolution or change is happening downwards, that's time one, time two, time three, and so on. This might be maybe 300 or 400 such steps. And then if we went down 101 times could we predict? My answer here is yes. There's obviously an emergent pattern here, and you could work out the pattern while you get bigger triangles and bigger versions of what was there previously. There's a lot of self-similarity here. So if you're any sort of a decent physicist or engineer or mathematician, you could sit down and maybe with about 2 hours of work, you could figure out what was going to happen and predict what it would exactly look like after a billion and 101 times, because there's such a strong pattern here. Well, is that always true of cellular automata? Here's a different one. As far as I understand it, Wolfram's using a different rule here, obviously, and starting them in slightly different places. There's one little pixel here, you can barely see it, that's black, and that leads to all of this, but that peters out. Same rule, started with two or three pixels that are black, that leads to all that. Slightly different starting point here. Point is, even if you know where you start in this, if you go down a few hundred steps, you cannot predict what the pattern's going to be. Time, remember, is going down in this direction. You can't predict it. The rule is incredibly simple, but there is no way to figure out where this sort of system is going to be unless you compute it. Now, this is a bit of a staggerer for people who follow the Newtonian thing. If it's scientific, if it's simple, these are simple rules, we should be able to predict. Well, you can only predict in such systems by computing them out. And there are other results, and these are very rigorous mathematical results by people like Chaitin that were foreshadowed by work of Turing and by Steve Wolfram as well, that say nearly all such simple systems are not predictable. That is, most such algorithms don't give you this sort of thing. If you chose algorithms at random, you'll find that they're not predictable unless you fully compute them out. Another thing, equation-based, well, obviously, algorithmically based, so we lose our equation-based. Though if an algorithm doesn't have side conditions or an inner state, then it's just simply pretty naturally equation-based. In other words, equations work well when systems are simple. I want to harp on this because usually I'm an economist, and I don't know if many physicists have said to me, economics, soft science. Physics, hard science. We can predict. You guys can't predict. It's not true. Economics is a complex science because a lot of things are going on that are context dependent. Economics is basically algorithmic, and it's complicated. Physics is generally complicated too. If I asked a physicist, I live on the San Andreas Fault in California, kindly predict me the next earthquake. It's purely physical. You're a physicist, you have a hard science, you can predict anything. They say, well, that's complicated. There's a lot of interactions. It's algorithmic. Fine. So equation-based, equations work well when systems are simple, but break down when it's complicated. There's a big objection. If algorithms are such wonderful items, are we stuck with these things? Do we have to read reams of computer programs? The answer is no. Here's an algorithmic system. This is a genetic regulatory network. Think of this as all the genetic switches that are turning genes off and on. Inside this, it looks to be some sort of floral organism. But this is a small picture of the genes that are switching on other genes to express protein and make a structure, or in this case, make some sort of thing actually show flowers, and switching off other genes So as an organism develops, as a flower develops, as the seasons change, different genes are switched on and off. And this is a massively logical interacting system, which you could say certainly is complicated or and maybe even complex. But notice that it's well represented. And if you were trained in genetic regulatory mechanisms, I can't do this, but probably if you were, you could glance at such a system and immediately read it. Just as I or you can read an equation, you could as easily read something like this and comprehend the whole thing. You could, in principle, write all this in equation form with zeros and ones and ifs and nots and things like that. Where I might be able to read this. I can't read this sort of a diagram, but I can read electronic circuits. I'm trained as an electrical engineer, and I can read digital electronic circuits as well. They look very much like this. That's what a real algorithm looks like. And don't forget, this is just part of a system. What about stasis or perfection or harmony and all this sort of thing? Well, in general, algorithmic systems do not lead to stasis or equilibrium. By the way, that is a very deep mathematical statement. It's not just arm waving. This is a mathematical statement. It follows from Turing's results on the decidability or the Entscheidungsproblem. It was taken up by Greg Chaitin. Wolfram has had a hand in this too. But basically, if you choose an algorithm at random and you say, does this thing settle down, does it go into cycles, the average or the random algorithm you choose will just work randomly. It will not necessarily settle down. And this, again, is a chilling thing for people who believe that the world is orderly. So let's go back to Mr. Alexander Pope and see what remains of his poem. All nature is but art, so all nature is mechanism unknown to thee. Well, maybe nature is mechanism, probably it is. But I would say all nature is not simple mechanism. All nature, if you think algorithmically, is organic. It's one thing building on another. It's one logic unfolding from another. And the situation and context are always changing. All chance direction which thou canst not see. Well, yeah, you can't, from Wolfram's results on prediction, you can't see where you're going next in general. You can for some very simple systems. All discord, harmony not understood. Well, from that last result, you don't get stasis, you don't get perfection, you usually don't get harmony, you don't get optimality. So all discord may remain discord and not very well understood officially. And all partial evil, universal good. Generally speaking, complex systems come out in a pretty good place, but not perfect optimality. And by the way, if you see the scars on me, it's for pointing that out in economics. That if you have a capitalist system, or in Berkeley where I studied, if you have a capitalist system, that system may not come out to the good of all. And you can certainly prove that sort of result. And I think it's perfectly realistic in the economy. So whatever is pretty good. But I would love to have had Alexander Pope around at the moment and finish up with whatever is probably workable. It doesn't quite have the same ring as this. I want to finish up here and point out some things. There's an architect that I follow, Robert Venturi. He was writing in the 60s, and he wrote a lovely book called, I think it was called The Architecture of Complexity. I may have the title slightly wrong. He wasn't talking about complexity in the modern form. He was talking about complication. And he was railing on about the Bauhaus and all these highly ordered mechanistic systems of Le Corbusier and people like that. And it was basically calling these prim dreams of pure order. So we have gone from the Enlightenment prim dreams of pure order. I think that maybe in those days, in the 1730s, things were so muddy and disordered, and there was hunger, and there was difficulty, and people were dying of things like smallpox or tuberculosis. Prim dreams of pure order were probably an Arcadia that people were hankering towards. We don't have that. We don't see the world anymore, except in very simple cases, as a beautiful machine. What we have is much more like this. This is a physical system. And again, I'm all in favor of physics and physicists. This is actually extracted from a block of ice on a lake in Alaska. These are the fractures, or the fracture planes in this block of ice. It's highly algorithmic. Depending on where the first fracture comes, that puts stresses on other places that fracture, that puts stresses on yet other fractures. So this is a logical thing that has worked out, depending on what happened originally. But notice that this is a world, again, to use Venturi's phrase, a world of messy vitality. I like the messiness, but I also like vitality is when systems are alive. They're not hugely ordered, but you can see there's quite a lot of order in this, and there's a lot of spectacular pattern emerged, but it's vital. This is much more what life is like. So what I'm saying here is science is shifting, and it's now expressible in algorithms, just like we saw with genetic regulatory networks. And by the way, these algorithms are what turns on this, that might turn on that, that might turn off this, in vastly complicated sequences that are logical and context dependent. So this means that science, via algorithms, can talk about, we can talk about a verb-based science. Biology is a verb-based science. This event leads to that event leads to other events, but not in a very deterministic way, because there are also probabilities, and that's how structure arises. Many sciences, 19th century physics, 20th century economics, I believe it's a science, many other sciences, most other sciences are noun-based. We talk about upsy-downsy economics, more inflation, or higher interest rates, lower inflation. So it's like a lot of little test tubes with liquid in them. The green liquid's going up, the blue liquid's going down, and that very, very noun-based. Being able to express things in terms of algorithm allows what I call procedural science. It allows science that's verb-based. This affects that affects this. This event leads to that event, and we can start to think of and fully encompass algorithms that depend on verbs. Here's Greg Chaitin, and I like this quote, so I put it up here. The computer, he says, is a revolutionary new kind of mathematics with profound philosophical consequences. It reveals a new world. He doesn't say the computer is a machine. For Chaitin and for Turing, the computer is an idea. It's a mathematical structure. It is that which works out the consequences of an algorithm. An algorithm is the program. We can imagine a mathematical construct that works out its consequences. Just like a plus sign is an abstract idea that works out the consequences of adding A and B together. A computer thought of by a mathematician is not a machine, it's a mathematical idea. And so this mathematical idea of computation or algorithms, he says, kind of mathematics with profound philosophical consequences. what are those consequences philosophically? I'm not a philosopher, but I'm going to give you 2 or 3 minutes worth of conjecture here. There may be people in the audience can nail this much better than I can. But something like this, what's the philosophy behind Newton's world? I was struck, almost stopped in my tracks. I was reading Schrödinger's autobiography quite a few years ago, and he mentions in there that Western science is the Greek way of looking at the world. Basically, we've inherited science as seeing the world as ordered, which comes from the ancient Greeks. It has come down to us very much through Plato, but Plato wasn't the first to think this way. There's a group of philosophers called the Eleatic philosophers that were pre-Socrates philosophers. Plato thought, as you know, in terms of ideals. So I could draw a circle here, but it's not a very good circle. In Plato's mind, there's a perfect circle. And that perfect circle is perfect eternally. Likewise, by extrapolation, there's a perfect horse. So you could show me an old nag, and I could say, it's a sort of a horse. It's only kind of approximating a horse. There's a perfect horse out there. By the way, there's a tale that in the, I don't know if this is true, but in the Greek Academy, there was an argument how many teeth a horse had. And the argument went on and on for days, and I don't know how it got settled, but it wasn't settled by going and looking at a horse, because that horse might not be the ideal horse, might not have the right number of teeth. So the ideal horse has the ideal number of teeth, and they probably settled it logically from there. But this is what we've inherited, a view of the world as consisting of these Platonic ideals that are beautiful, that are harmonic, that are eternal. And these are ideals of order and perfection. And that's basically what gave us the Enlightenment and the Greek way of looking at the world. And that's very much behind what Newton is talking about. What philosophy might lie behind Turing's world? Well, that's a huge, huge, huge question. And I just want to give you my 2 bits worth here. But I'll just say what is important in this algorithmic world is process. But it's process within a context. And the processes change the context, which change the processes. So this is the world that I would say is a world of complexity. It's a world of process, of massively parallel processes interacting. And what counts is the propensity of things. There's a kind of interweaving tendency and propensity of all these interlocking, interlacing, inter-evolving processes. And really what counts is the potential of such a system to do certain things at a certain time. We don't have a word for that in English, but in French it's called la logique des choses. It's the tendency or the logic of things to play out the way they do play out. Secondly, we are in a world that's ever shifting. So in general, the algorithmic world doesn't settle down. It doesn't necessarily reach any ideal conclusion. Just like the evolution of species, it goes on and on, evolving new things. Important is not control. We are not people in a gigantic power station fiddling with the levers and the wheels and the switches. This is something Dave Collender has pointed out in a recent book, by the way, to do with economies. What's important is not control, because you can't get control over such a system. You can't understand it well enough. You can't see what the future is well enough. What's important is appropriate reaction. If you're standing on a surfboard, and believe it or not, I used to have a board in Hawaii years ago. what's important is not control. You can't say in advance where you're going to go. What's important is that you're reacting to how the wave is changing. And you're looking ahead a little bit and reacting. What I want to point out here is that, the person who's thought most about that in Western philosophy is Alfred North Whitehead. As it's quite a very deep philosopher and not much studied, but heavily studied, interestingly enough, in China. He thought a lot and wrote a lot about process. What philosophy, well, compare that with ancient Chinese philosophy. Notice that I just left all the writing here identical. We've taken Whitehead out. And the only thing that changes is the heading. Ancient Chinese philosophy, what is important is process. They have a whole book about that called the Yi Jing. Process within a context, the process changes the context, context changes the process. What's important is the propensity of things, that things are moving and shifting, and there's a logic or a tendency to go one way or the other. The world is ever changing, ever shifting, never settling down. What's as important is not control, but appropriate reaction. If you study Qigong or Kung Fu, and you have an opponent, let's say, in martial arts, the opponent's standing here, you can't control the situation. The opponent makes a move. All you can do is react. You can react to that move, and then maybe you can come in with a fresh move. But you're reacting and changing as the situation evolves. And this is very, very much a Chinese way of looking at the world. Now, I don't want to oversimplify, as Doug was pointing out, and I don't want to romanticize this, but I find this quite remarkable. Western philosophy or Western science has gone through all this rationality and all this mechanism as finally ending up where Chinese philosophy pretty much starts 2,000 years ago. I want to leave you with this character. It's the character for harmony. I will not attempt to pronounce it in Chinese. There are many people in the audience would know this. But the character for harmony in Chinese, as I understand it, and I've been studying this on and off for close to 30 years, Chinese philosophy or Taoist philosophy in particular. Harmony in Chinese philosophy, as I understand it, doesn't mean that everything is hunky-dory or everything has reached some stasis that we think is wonderful. Harmony is very much that the situation's always changing. It's more like riding a bicycle. The situation's always changing, and you're always adjusting. So harmony means when you are in working in conjunction with these processes that are evolving naturally, and you continue to do that. This is very much the sort of outcome we would hope for and try to get in complex systems. I want to point out also that these last few ideas are being investigated by my introducer, Jonathan Sim, and Jan Vassbinder, and the Institute Paralimas is holding a very small discussion group or workshop on these ideas as seen through their own lenses. So please don't think that I'm preempting any of the discussion. But those are very much my own take on this. I do think we are entering a new era with being able to express science in terms of algorithms. We can encompass more of the world, not all of the world, but the part that's context dependent. And seeing things in terms of context and context dependence was certainly part of Western thinking up until Socrates, and it's been part of Chinese thinking all along. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have some time for questions. Does anyone have a question for Professor Arthur? Okay, the gentleman over there.
Need a mic.
Does anybody have a mic?
There's a bit. There's something.
Hi. So I love this talk, but I'm a big fan of Newton. And one comment is that before Newton wrote the Principia, he wrote a tract called De Motu. And in that tract is a section called the Copernican Scolium that now recent Newton scholars have kind of picked up on this. And that's a paragraph where, so this is a little bit before the Principia, and Newton is thinking about these, you know, if you have forces on planets and things like that, how that would work out. And he realizes that, okay, if there's a force of the sun on a particular planet, then the third law of motion shows that, okay, there must be a force of that planet back on the sun. And if so, then each of the planets exerts a force on the sun, and you know that. So the sun is never, it's always moving, which means that. And there's a quote that you might like where he says something like, "If I am not mistaken, the complexities of the motions of the solar system are beyond the power of any human intellect," and then. It's something like that, but a lot of people think that, you know, that was one of the things that motivated Newton to write the Principia. That is, he's trying to come up with some way of, you know, addressing this immense complexity, and Newton's way is sort of, he finds out a way of, maybe if you put it. In terms of, okay, he's trying to come up with a simple set of rules with which to deal with the complexity.
Is there a question or a comment?
Okay, well, that is a comment. I hope you like that one. But the comment is that, the question is, if you look at what Newton does, a lot of it, what's important is involves, number one, measurement. Okay, and number two, measurement of masses of the bodies in the solar system, things like that. A lot of the evidence that comes from Newtonian physics comes out of the measurements and the deviations from the measurements from which you, and those deviations, you know, lead to things like the discovery of Uranus, or ultimately to the discovery of general relativity, right? Yeah. So I'm wondering if that sort of reasoning can be done. I mean, in this new sort of paradigm that you're suggesting.
Yeah, of course, such reason can be done algorithmically, because algorithms can reduce very quickly to equations, if that's what you want to do. I'm certainly not saying that Newton thought the world was simple. Newton probably had, as you're saying, had a very good intuitive grasp of the three-body problem. It's easy enough to say if there's a sun and one planet, what's going to happen. The moment you throw in another planet, we've known from the time of Poincaré onwards, so around late 1800s, early 1900s, that that's basically not very predictable at all in the long term, because that becomes immediately complicated. So I don't want to say that all Newtonian systems in equation form are simple. I do want to say that the ones that can be expressed in equation form tend to be a lot simpler than the ones that you can grasp in algorithmic form. And yes, it's true that if a planet is in gravitational orbit around the sun, the sun is also, to some degree, under the influence of the planet's gravity. That's how exoplanets are discovered, or used to be discovered. planets around far solar systems, you see a sun through a telescope, and that sun is moving. You can actually measure it in terms of, say, 20 feet per second this way or that way. You can infer that you can't see the planet, but you can infer there is a planet. So yes, Newtonian equations can very often, if you take them seriously, give you quite a complicated world, and there is a world of perturbations, which you appear to be trained in, and I am too. I don't want to say the Newtonian system is always simple, but equations tend to capture much simpler systems than algorithms can.
Thank you. Well, it's clear that in computer science and biology and sociology and economy, many models are algorithmic. But the question is whether you're aware or have any insights whether algorithms might be used in physics, because physicists are stuck with equations even if they're extremely complicated, that's what they like.
Yeah.
But I don't know, maybe for exploring fluid dynamics, algorithms might be much simpler, but I don't know whether anybody in physics dares to make that step.
Well, we have an expert here in fluid dynamics, but I don't want to say that algorithmic, that all physics systems up until, say, 1900, they were all expressed in terms of equations. But I don't want to say they're simple. In fact, a lot of the interest in modern physics is in viewing complex, highly interactive parallel systems, and those are very physical. It's not, so I'm not saying physics is Newtonian, far from it. What I'm saying is that we've moved beyond seeing the world as knowable and rather simple and easily expressed in terms of smooth equations, and being event-driven, depending on its context. The distinction I want to make is that many sciences, quite legitimately in many parts of sciences, can be noun-based and rather simple, but also science is now opening up to verb-based sciences. How genetic regulatory mechanisms trigger events that change the context for other types of events to be triggered, all of this working in parallel. So being able to express things only in terms of equations tends to be rather restrictive. Once you open up to algorithms, you can have an event-based type of science, or what I call a procedural science, or if you prefer, verb-based sciences. And I can tell you, viewing the world that way gives you a very different way of looking at everything. And basically, that's the complexity approach.
The gentleman in white.
Thank you very much.
That's working.
For your talk, I have long been fascinated by Alan Turing's work, and now finally understand why. I want to ask you a question about the analysis of inertia in the study of human behavior. I, for some years, have been making an argument that there is a fundamental logical error in archaeological reasoning, where what archaeologists tend to do is to see the material as a reflection of a social, of something else.
Yeah.
And I've argued for some time that the material is the context of the social and not necessarily in correspondence in it,
yeah,
much as you have argued with technology,
yeah,
and economics.
Yeah.
What was revealed in this is that this leads on to an argument of being able to make a calculation of the role of inertia. In my own case, for instance, in Angkor, people who are locked into dealing with structures which are so huge,
yeah,
that when they go wrong, they can't do anything,
yeah,
about them.
Yeah.
And that there should, in principle, be a way of actually creating algorithms,
yeah,
for that relationship,
yeah,
between the material and the social,
yeah,
that would, for instance, allow us to turn the histories of cities,
yes,
into some kind of predictive pattern. I don't mean a simple predictive pattern, but a pattern of the kind that you're talking about, of the way the state of the city relates to the states that it then moves into.
Yeah.
That was really remarkable. Thank you very much.
Thank you. My suspicion is that what you're talking about is much deeper than what I can answer here. What I will say is that what I'm saying is that science is moving from just, it's long moved since Turing, but science is moving from just saying, here's where we are, given that, here's where we're going to go next, and that context is important, and we can now build that in officially, rigorously, algorithmically, and therefore mathematically. An algorithm is mathematical. Once you start to look at context, and this is the subject of a lot of early work I did on lock-in and increasing returns, context can lock you in. And this is true archaeologically, it's true in every dimension, that a society creates technologies, or it creates certain objects, or it creates certain behaviors, and those behaviors can turn into structures that in turn lock the society in. And that's one reason, and again, I can articulate this rigorously in economics. I'm not an archaeologist, but it's one reason that societies don't tend to change smoothly as they ought to if it was just pure differential equations. They tend to lurch. A system will lock you in because you have those technologies, you know how they work, you know what they're doing. And then when times get tough, you're locked in and you can't get out of that. And then something collapses. And then suddenly you lurch into a slightly different system. I don't want to go beyond that, but once you have context in there, literally in the equation, so to speak, in the system as Turing showed us how to do, then you're in a very different world that's nowhere near as smooth. It's lock in and then lurch. It's a lurching kind of world that goes like that and then like this, and rather than unfold smoothly. I noticed that when the equation-based system was at its zenith, which might have been the 1890s or pre-Turing, there was a deep Victorian belief that nature makes no leaps. Marshall, in 1891, Alfred Marshall wrote Principles of Economics, but the slogan was Natura non facit saltum, nature makes no leap. Very Victorian idea. Now, in the 21st century, with all this sort of thinking, we're realizing it's full of leaps and lurchings and abrupt changes and abrupt shifts, and then that changes the context for everything else.
I'd be interested to know, thank you, Brian, for a fantastic talk. I'd be interested to know your observations that, on the one hand, Western mind seems to be moving towards the Chinese where 2,000 years ago, yet if you go to Shanghai, you see the opposite happening in the body. And there's a convergence and a fluid, if you like, harmony within that. I'd be very interested to know what your observations or thoughts are on that particular convergence.
Well, I find it very amusing. I've been in Shanghai, and as an economist, I would declare Shanghai publicly to be the most capitalist city in the world. Ferraris, Gucci shoes, the whole works. And yet we are discovering in the West some truisms that never left China and that were deeply thought out in China. What I would like to think is that in our hubris in the West with science, nobody can touch us, where Western science, the greatest thing going is modern physics. I believe all that. That's a staggering accomplishment for human beings. But I find it funny and rather beautiful that as the more deep physics and science gets, the more it's coming back to some of these eternal truths. There's a thought I'd like to give you. There's a beautiful book written by Ian McGilchrist called The Master and His Emissary. But it's basically pointing out, and I don't want to oversimplify this, he's a neuroscientist, and he's a philosopher. He's Scottish. And he's pointing out that there is a highly focused, logical way of thinking that works in terms of rationality and is more associated with the left hemisphere. And there's a pattern recognition, contingency, context part of the brain that's more associated with the right hemisphere. It's a rather thick book, but to simplify my whole argument, I would say the Chinese have articulated the right brain way of looking at the world beautifully, deeply, and in a way that's far richer than I can encompass in two slides. As we have gone into the left brain logical way of looking at the world, we kind of pinpointed all of that, and then it burst open. The more you press on some Western ideal, you know, what is beauty? What is truth? Can you prove everything using axioms? Then if you press on those very hard, they tend to burst open, and you find you're in the right brain. So according to McGilchrist, at least, we're achieving a balance. That cheers me up. I'm not so much cheered up by where China's going, but there are deep thinkers in China, and they're starting to discover complexity. I was invited to China 2 years ago by some Taoist masters, and I said, what am I doing here? Why did you want to talk to me? And they said, we think you're doing the same as us. And I said, what do you mean? He said, you study complexity. We study the same thing. We just have different words. Can we talk to you? So this cheers me up. It's not the last word. I think Jan and Jonathan are onto that, that there's actually two worlds here. There's the Asian world. There's the right brain world. I'm not saying Asians aren't logical, but their philosophy has developed very much the right brain approach. And they're discovering this left brain, very Western approach. We're discovering their approach. I think there's an awful lot of dialogue to happen. And this will be a rich dialogue, and it'll be far deeper than two slides here can show.
Yeah, unfortunately, we have run out of time. So we'd like to thank Professor Arthur for his presentation.
Thank you very much.
On behalf of everyone here, a token of our gratitude.
Thank you indeed. Thank you.
Thank you.